so in this video we're going to have a look at carbon dioxide transport. Now, carbon dioxide is carried around in the blood in three different ways. Some of it, a small proportion of it, is dissolved directly in the plasma. It will diffuse out of the cells into the tissue fluid, and as the tissue fluid moves back into all the plasma, it's taken with it, and the carbon dioxide will be dissolved in it. Some of it travels bound to hemoglobin. Now, when carbon dioxide binds directly to hemoglobin, it forms something called carbaminohemoglobin. So carbaminohemoglobin is carbon dioxide directly bound to the hemoglobin travelling in the red blood cells. The rest of it, the majority of it, about 85% of it, travels as hydrogen carbonate ions in the plasma. Now, when carbon dioxide moves into the blood, it diffuses into the red blood cells. Obviously, a small proportion of it stays in the plasma. The rest moves into the red blood cells. So carbon dioxide moves into the red blood cells, and it combines with water, absorbs in the water, to form carbonic acid, what we're trying to draw. Now, that reaction is catalyzed by an enzyme called carbonic anhydrase. And the reaction is actually reversible. Now, carbonic acid, so that's the carbonic acid. Carbonic acid dissociates. So the carbonic acid dissociates to form hydrogen ions and hydrogen carbonate ions. Now, if you are not confident with formulas, stick to the words, because if you get them wrong or if you contradict yourselves, you won't get the marks. So hydrogen carbonate ions. Now, those hydrogen carbonate ions leave the red blood cell. They leave the red blood cell, and chloride ions move in instead. So they go out, chloride ions go in. And that's something known as the chloride shift, just to keep a balance of the ions. So hydrogen carbonate is what your majority of your carbon dioxide is carried as. So your carbon dioxide enters your red blood cell, carbonic anhydrase catalyzes the reaction to form carbonic acid dissociates to form your hydrogen carbonate, and then it's carried in the plasma to the lungs. Once it gets to the lungs, this reverse reaction, that reverse reaction, that reverse reaction happens to get carbon dioxide, which is what we breathe out. Okay, so that's how your carbon dioxide is transported. Now, those hydrogen ions that are formed are a bit of a problem. If they're just in your blood, they're going to reduce the pH, they're going to start to affect proteins, enzymes, hormones, any of the proteins that are trapped in your blood. So they have to be dealt with. Now, they are picked up by hemoglobin. They combine to hemoglobin. And when they bind to hemoglobin, they form hemoglobinic acid, which sometimes gets abbreviated to HA3. Kind of make that quite difficult there. Hemoglobinic acid. Now, because your hemoglobin can bind hydrogen ions, that gets sort of effectively taking the hydrogen ions out of the equation. That's why we say the blood or hemoglobin acts as a buffer. It's absorbing those hydrogen ions so that they don't affect the proteins around them. So the formation of hemoglobinic acid is really, really important. Now, when hydrogen ions bind to hemoglobin, the oxygen that they are carrying, that the hemoglobin is carrying, dissociates from the oxyhemoglobin. So along with the formation of that, you get the release of oxygen. So oxygen is released, hydrogen ions are picked up. Now that's very important, because if you have a lot of carbon dioxide, you're going to get a lot of hydrogen carbonate ions, you're going to have a lot of hydrogen ions, which means you're going to form a lot of hemoglobinic acid, giving up a lot of oxygen. So where you have a tissue with a lot of carbon dioxide, a heavily respiring tissue, for example, the hemoglobin, the oxyhemoglobin, gives up more oxygen. And that's exactly what you want. If you are a heavily respiring tissue, you're running out of oxygen because you're using it in respiration. You're producing a lot of carbon dioxide. And so the carbon dioxide triggers this process so that you, as a tissue, then get more oxygen. And you're probably running out of oxygen. So that ensures that tissues that are heavily respiring get the oxygen that they need for that respiration. Now that increase in carbon dioxide affects your oxygen dissociation curve. So this is what it's like under normal carbon dioxide levels, and we've already had a look at this in a previous video. So we're still having a look at the partial pressure of oxygen. Now if you increase the carbon dioxide level, what happens is that your graph moves down, moves down and to the right. So down and to the right. So your line is further down, further to the right than your kind of your normal or your low level of carbon dioxide. So this is what happens if you have a higher level of carbon dioxide. Okay? Now this effect is known as the Bohr shift. So the Bohr effect or the Bohr shift is when you increase the carbon dioxide levels. And so what that means is that, so say the partial pressure here, normally you would have given up, remember to work out your maximum, you would have given up that much oxygen. That much would still be saturated, you'd have given up that much. Now if you do the same one for this line, let's do it in red still, if you do the same partial pressure of oxygen for this line, you can see suddenly you've given up far more oxygen because you're a heavily respiring tissue. You want more oxygen because you're respiring, you're using it, but equally you're producing more carbon dioxide, which is leading to this set of events. Okay? So the Bohr shift is the effect that an increased carbon dioxide level has, and the effect of that, the result of that, is that heavily respiring tissues get the oxygen that they need. Okay? Now, these oxygen dissociation curves are quite frequently in exams. So we're going to have a look at an example. So for example, if you've got your normal oxygen dissociation curve, you can have a look at the effect of an environment where there's less oxygen. Now, in an environment where there is less oxygen available, your line is shifted left. Now, that happens in fetal hemoglobin. Now, when humans are fetuses, they have different hemoglobin. It's called fetal hemoglobin. Fetal hemoglobin has a much higher affinity for oxygen, an attraction for oxygen. It will bind oxygen more readily than adult hemoglobin. Now, shortly after you're born, red blood cells only last kind of 3 months or so. Shortly after you're born, every red blood cell, new red blood cell that you make, has adult hemoglobin with that lower affinity. Now, that's really important because if you think about where the fetus is, inside the mother's uterus, it's in an environment where it can't control the breathing, it's reliant on the mother, but it's in an environment where there's going to be less oxygen available. The mother's going to be using some of that oxygen herself. And so by the time the blood gets to the fetus, it's going to be lower in oxygen. So if you have a look at a particular partial pressure of oxygen, where the mother will have given up, say, that much oxygen, that's where the fetus is still heavily saturated because it is grabbing that oxygen from the mother. It has a stronger affinity, a higher affinity, a stronger attraction. And so it kind of steals the oxygen from the mother. And so what that means is that your graft is shifted left. Now, that also happens in your muscles. Your muscles have something called myoglobin. And myoglobin also has higher affinity for oxygen. And again, if you are a muscle tissue, you are heavily respiring, you're going to want to attract more oxygen. The same would be for any organism that's in a lower oxygen environment. For example, animals that kind of burrow in the sand and so are submerged for some of the time, animals that live at altitude, the llamas that I talked about, their grafts will be shifted slightly. They hold on to their oxygen. They are better at grabbing hold of it, keeping hold of it, and so they have this higher affinity. And when you look at their oxygen dissociation curves, they are shifted that way from somebody in your kind of average, normal range of oxygen.